Okay. Hi, Julia.
Hi, Aya. How are you?
I'm doing very well. So did you have a nice Thanksgiving?
I did, but I ate too much. So, you know, I probably need to recover.
Yeah, I have to watch what I eat because while I'm not on the carnivore diet anymore, and I do allow myself to eat some carbs, I still don't need to eat too many carbs. So I try to maintain, you know, to eat mostly meat, mm-hmm. mostly fat, but I allow myself some leeway.
Well, that's a good, like, option or balance, since I know the carnivore diet seems to be working for you a lot, right? You've seen some benefits from it, correct?
I have. And then I kind of fell off it, and then I had a little bit of a health disaster, and then I was going to go to Israel, so I didn't go right back on the carnivore diet because I wanted to enjoy the Mediterranean diet that we have
in
Israel.
Yeah, best hummus on the planet. Like, do the right thing. Yeah.
Right, but I'm still interested in the carnivore diet and the health benefits from it.
Yeah.
So, you know that Amber O'Hearn, she actually has an L in front of her name. So it's like L. Amber O'Hearn will be our guest.
Oh, okay. Nice.
On December the 13th. And she's going to talk to us about nutrition.
I read some of her bio. She sounds like a very interesting person, and I'll be very fascinated to hear the things she has to share with us that I think might help a lot of our viewers who are interested in the carnivore diet.
Yes, and it will help people who work with chimpanzees too, because I'm going to be asking her not just about nutrition for human beings, but nutrition for other animals, including dogs and parrots.
For sure. I might be interested for the cat, because our cat, it seems like all our cat wants to eat is salmon or shrimp. Oh. I would be curious, do you think she knows anything about cat nutrition and why our cat... It's really sick if we feed it certain kinds of cat food, but shrimp and salmon seem to be okay.
Huh. I'm sure you could ask her. She actually strikes me as a cat person. I could be wrong. But if I had to guess whether she was a dog person or a cat person, I would think she was a cat person.
Okay. I would just love to ask her, because we've been plagued with this. We keep trying different types of cat food, and sometimes it's... We don't know. Like, cats can't quite process their food like other animals. They do throw up some of their food, but there's something, we just want to give her a better combination of things that agree with her, that's all.
Right. And there's this really, I don't think that right now in our society, any of us know what anybody should be eating. There's this real struggle. Everybody struggles with it.
Definitely. I mean, look at the diet industry. It kind of preys among people that feel insecure. They want to lose weight. They want to be healthier, but then they don't have good long-term results with that. You know, they need more guidance, I think.
Right. I mean, people used to know what it was that they ate because they just followed the tradition of their people. You know, grandma cooked and then mom cooked the way grandma cooked and so on and so forth. And as long as people just followed the tradition and didn't ask themselves, well, what actually do we get out of this? What's the nutritional value of all this? They were fine. But I think it started in the 1950s, right after World War II, that at least in the United States, all these dietitians took over and started telling people, you know, the way you've been eating hasn't been good.
So that might have been to the detriment of many people. But I also think, too, like a lot of, I don't think everybody always eats exactly the way that they, that a diet. I think another problem is we have a lot of overabundance of like processed carbs, like cakes, cookies, things like that, which people just, we have a lot of overabundance of things that people didn't used to eat. Like grandma would make a pie. It was a treat. It wasn't something like, oh, every day, like, you got an A on the report card. Let's go get a pie at Costco. Like, I think it's been a, you know what I'm saying?
Yes. There is a superabundance of that, but we're also, a lot of people are just refraining from eating fatty foods. And mm-hmm. that is making them overweight, you know, because when people used to eat the the basic breakfast involving maybe an egg and some bacon or something like that, it was mostly fat. And right now, you know, that they were later told that was completely wrong, so they should eat mostly carbs. And when they ate that, they got a lot of energy right away, but then they ran out of energy faster, so then they felt like they had to eat some more, you know. And
yeah, it does, it feeds like a circle of overeating for sure.
Right. So, and now a lot of people are breaking up into camps. So there's the animal, the people like carnivore diet, where they think that it has to all come from animals, and the people like vegans who think it all has to come from non-animal, from plant life. But it might not even be that that's really the issue. The issue, it might be, what sort of nutrients do we need and how do we digest those nutrients? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that would be a really good question. Now, Amber O'Hearn might be interested in knowing, maybe she already knows about this, but there were a lot of people that were following like really extreme vegan diets, like, which I didn't get, like the raw foodists, where they were just eating fruit and vegetables, and now a lot of them have become carnivores. She might know a little bit about that, but maybe...
Yeah, she herself came from that kind of a background. She wasn't always a carnivore, obviously. Mm-hmm. And she only did it because it made her feel healthier. She didn't do it out of ideological reasons at all.
Okay, yeah, she just was trying to be healthier, it sounds like. I just thought it was interesting, though. A lot of people got really sick. But I kind of said that because I don't think you're supposed to just eat fruit. It's probably not healthy.
Well, you know, I mean, even in the bird community, it sounds funny to say the bird community, but, you know, the people who like parrots, and I've been sort of following Marlene McCohen because she had some advice that really helped me to deal with Summer when I first had to take over the care for Summer, our parrot, yeah. You know, because it was not my parrot, it was Sword. And when Sword went off to college, I had to take care of Summer, so I learned a lot of important things from Marlene McCohen about how to get closer to a parrot, because when at first he was very cage possessive, cage aggressive. I couldn't change his water as food without almost getting bitten, you know.
And wow, you've made a lot of, I've seen like he sits on your shoulder. It's so different than what it was.
Yeah. Yeah. So I had to learn, because that just didn't seem like something I wanted to have continue in that way. So I had to learn how to get closer to him and have him trust me and have a better relationship. So I did learn a lot from Marlene McCohen. I am concerned that people in that group, I'm not saying she herself, but people in that group are telling people to take their birds who have been eating seeds all their lives and put them on a vegetable diet. And I'm concerned about that.
No, but seeds are really nutritious. Why would they say, I mean, I like nuts and seeds. It might not be for everybody, but why would they say a bird can't eat that?
Well, here's what they say, and it doesn't make sense to me. They say, listen, yes, we do know that in the wild, birds like to eat seeds, but they have to travel far and wide to look for those seeds. They burn a lot of energy looking for those seeds. The seeds are a high nutrient dense food, and when you have a bird that's sitting in a cage most of the day and not doing much of anything, even if your bird does fly around your house a little bit, your bird isn't working so much, therefore your bird should be eating carbs. And the thing that's wrong with that isn't the part about the energy usage of the bird. I agree, my bird does not work as hard for his food as he would if he were out in the wild. But the part of the reasoning that does not make sense to me in there is the idea that if you eat carbs, you're not going to get fat, or that if you eat carbs, you're not going to have a super abundance of calories that you don't know what to do with. Because actually, when you eat a lot of carbs, you tend to gain weight. When you eat a lot of fat, you tend to lose weight, or at least maintain your weight about the same.
it can spike your insulin level where you're not going to lose weight. No, that was a big problem with humans too. Remember I was telling you about all the people, like the pseudoscience people that were like, eat a big bowl of pasta every day. Like, no, that, if you tell a bird like that, if you tell the same thing to somebody who owns a bird, you're going to get the same result with your bird if you aren't feeding the bird things that are nutrient-dense. Nutrient-dense foods are good for us. Why do we think the opposite? That makes no sense to me.
Yeah, so this is where I think they're going wrong, and I think they're going wrong because they also don't understand the human situation. But the other, so, you know, we could say it's really not about eating animals versus eating plants. You could say that it has more to do with how much fat there is in your diet as opposed to how much of your diet is carbs. But there's also another issue, and that's kind of, I was listening to Amber O'Hearn and she was talking, and as long as she was just talking about human nutrition, I was listening, but I wasn't that excited. Then she started to talk about chimpanzees and other apes. And mm-hmm. It turns out that the chimpanzee has a cecum, which is a part of the digestive tract that we don't, and has a longer colon than we do.
Oh.
So, you know, we talk about how this chimpanzee is 98% the same as we are DNA-wise. And sometimes people say, oh, but their brain is a little bit smaller. But hardly ever do they say, oh, but their intestines are much longer. Nobody says that.
Maybe because people don't really know, like, unless you're really into the chimpanzee, like, studying the dietary track of it. Maybe a lot of people just are not aware of this, and Amber O'Hearn has some information that people need to learn about.
Right. And so, you know, she doesn't deny the fact that chimpanzees do eat meat. They obviously do. They have.
Oh, they do in the wild for sure,
yes.
Right?
I mean, don't yes. They yes, but they're not very successful hunters. So a huge part of their diet isn't meat. They'd like it to be meat. They would be happy if it were meat, but it isn't. It's not that they can't eat meat, but they have to hunt for it and they don't always get any. You understand what
I'm
saying?
It's going to be difficult. Like maybe they can get a small bird or something that's kind of.
Well, they actually do eat small monkeys, but they don't catch a small monkey every day. Okay. That just doesn't happen every day.
Okay. I didn't know that. See, very interesting. I didn't know about this.
Yeah, I know. And it's not like a chimpanzee living in my house would ever want to eat a monkey. That's not.
He would freak out.
Yeah, it's a totally cultural thing. But getting back to the nutrition. Okay, so let's just say maybe they eat 80% plant-based diet. Mm-hmm. And that would make you think, oh, so they're like us and we're like them and we should be vegetarian. But here's the thing that I learned from Amber O'Hearn's talk, is actually they either eat the same thing twice. They don't have a second stomach the way, you know, a cow would have
like
several
cow, stomachs. Yeah, they can eat just all the grass at once.
Okay, well, they don't have that. But they do redigest the same food. They chew the same food over and over and over again. And I know that to be a fact. Okay. I know that from my own experiences with both. So in fact, what they're doing is they're distilling their food and they're designed to have very high fiber food. You know, a lot of it is not fruit, it's leaves. And even if it is fruit, the fruit has a lot of fiber. It's not like the apples that we have.
No, the apples that, well, actually, the homegrown apple is a lot different than what you buy in the store. A homegrown pear is really tiny. It's not like this big, like, hi, here I am.
That's true, but even the ones that we consider heritage apples, they've already undergone a lot of human selection.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I see what you're saying. Like a wild apple is going to be very dense.
Yeah,
and fibrous.
It's going to be very fibrous. It's not going to have nearly as much sugar in it. It's not going to have nearly as much stuff that a human being could actually digest. You know how most people like to peel their apples and they don't even eat the peel?
Oh, they do. I've heard of that, but I eat the peel.
Yeah, I did. As long as my digestion allowed me to, I did eat the peel. But what Bo would do with the peel is he would eat it again and again and again. You know what I'm saying? He was distilling something out of it that would be digestible. Huh. That wouldn't just go in one end and out the other just to clean out your gut.
I know what you're saying, because that's what happens if you eat an apple.
Yeah, that's all it does. It cleans out your gut. And if you're a young person and you have a strong gut, it doesn't hurt. As you get older and your gut becomes not as good, it can actually hurt you to receive too much fiber.
Some people I've heard, I know there's an actual name for this condition where you cannot digest any plant fiber. I've heard about that and read about that.
But I mean, there's the soluble fiber that you're never intended to actually digest, so to speak. You're just intended to pass it through your body and come out the other end.
Yeah, of course. I guess what I'm trying to say is some people can't eat, ingest any of that fiber. I've heard about that.
Yeah, and I wouldn't say that my situation is that bad, but I'm not that young, and I can tolerate a lot less fiber than I could when in my youth. So that's something that changes over time.
I think that's typical for a lot of people. Like, they're not going to be eating like they did when they were 19. That's just not how our bodies are designed.
Right. So anyway, going back to chimpanzees and what they do with fiber, they actually turn fiber into something edible. I mean, something digestible that can be an energy source for them. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that brings us to a different dichotomy, not the dichotomy between plants and animals as sources of food, but the dichotomy between ketosis and I think it's called glycolysis, but I could be mispronouncing that. So what we're talking about is, what is our main source of energy? And this is not even on the food level. It's on, you know, it's on the digestive level. Mm-hmm. And it turns out that ketosis, I mean, you've heard of ketosis, right?
Yeah, the ketogenic ketosis is really, it's really big right now.
Right. And people used to think, oh, that's what happens when you're on a starvation diet. You don't have enough to eat. And then your body starts eating itself to keep itself going. But that's not necessarily the case. What it is that you've got fat stores in all of us. And this is not even about being overweight. You know, perfectly normal human being, perfectly good BMI, normal weight, has fat stores. And one of the reasons we have fat stores is that we could just get energy out of those. Okay? Mm-hmm. And another talk that I saw by Amber O'Hearn, she was talking about children, you know, normal children, not children with a disease, but
just normal.
Yeah, normal children are in ketosis a lot of the time, even if they're eating a lot of carbs. You know, it's not that you put a child on a fat-only diet and then he'll go into ketosis. Very small children go into ketosis on a regular basis. And in fact, when they have those growth spurts, you know how sometimes a child will get a little bit chubby, but it's nothing to worry about because in the growth spurt, he suddenly uses up all those fat stores.
Yeah.
And that's perfectly normal.
Of course, yeah.
So now here's my question, and it's a question that I hope that Amber O'Hearn will be able to answer for us on December the 13th. Which is a Friday, so it's going to be Friday the 13th, and it will be at 8:45 p.m. Central Time. And what time will it be in California?
It'll be 6:45 Pacific Standard Time.
Okay, so the question I would like to ask, and I'm going to ask you first, and you tell me if it sounds like a good question or have any questions as to what it means, is, are there any animals that live entirely on ketosis or almost entirely on ketosis? And are there any animals that live almost entirely on, you know, a glucose-based energy source? Do you see what I'm saying?
That's a good question. And I almost had a question for you. What I was trying to figure out was, why are children in ketosis more often, no matter what they eat, than adults? Is it just because of their growing? Is that the reason?
I think it's because when we're young, our bodies work better. Mm-hmm. So this is my guess, but I don't know if it's true. And we'll ask Amber.
Yeah. Maybe that's a question that I would like to know.
Yeah. I think that a truly healthy human being is in ketosis most of the time, because that's actually better than the glucose metabolism. So I think hunter-gatherers were in ketosis most of the time. And you can see that happening because their bodies their bodies had a lot of muscle on them. You know, mm-hmm. their muscle to fat ratio was such.
Very muscular, yes.
Yes. So it's not that they didn't have any fat. All human beings have fat on them. But they were managing their fat very well. Let's put it that way.
Oh, yeah. Their bodies were well working machines. And then I guess this is another question about sedentary versus physically active lifestyles. Because right now, I wonder where Amber O'Hearn lies on this, because it seems like now they just push going to the gym. Like, the gym will solve all your problems. But we kind of neglect to mention that people used to be much more active, especially in hunter and gatherer times.
Yeah, the thing about the gym is if you drive your car to the gym and then use some kind of machine to force your body to work out, I don't think that's going to have the same effect as if you were walking all day long and that was your form of locomotion, you know, your primary.
Yeah, exactly. Like, just maybe walking but I don't want to get off topic. So I would like to ask her about her thoughts on that.
Yeah, but what I got was that maybe in a healthy situation, we would all continue as we were as children. And it wouldn't necessarily be that you couldn't eat carbs or you couldn't eat, you know, vegetables or whatever it is you like to eat. Mm-hmm. It's just that your body would naturally go to that form of subsistence, of that way of getting energy.
Yeah, I see exactly what you're saying. Your body's just a well-functioning engine when you're younger, and just as the car ages and a human ages, I don't think we can continue to eat a certain way past a certain age. Well, maybe some people can. Some people can. The hometown buffet guy can. Oh, boy. We called him the hometown buffet guy because he could go there and eat 7 plates of anything he wanted, and he was in his 70s and slim as can be, so he's just an anomaly. He can eat whatever he wants.
Right. And I'm not sure that all animals are the same, because I really do believe that a hummingbird is probably on sugar. But how long does a hummingbird last? You know, how long can it live?
It's not a very long life compared to other bird spans. Like, if you compare it to, I guess, like the bald eagle, I don't think they live as long.
Yeah, hold on a moment.
Okay.
Hold
that thought. Definitely. So we will be very interested to ask Amber O'Hearn all these ideas about, I want to learn more about like ketosis versus being on a glycogen-based diet. So that'll be very fascinating. She seems to have a lot of interesting insights for us. And I was just saying, like, when you left, I want to know the differences between being on a ketosis-based diet versus a glycogen-based diet. I'm very curious.
So that's something to look forward to. And I think at this point, we could end this meeting.
Okay.
And look forward to seeing you again, Julia.
Definitely.